So just like it's useful to be able to understand the limit of a scalar function, it can also be useful to understand how to take the limit of a vectored valued function. And that's what we're going to talk about in this video. And really, practically, this is going to look a lot like taking the limit of a scalar function, with just a few simple differences. But let's start with a definition. So this definition states that the vector valued function r of t approaches a limit L as t approaches a, that is, the limit as t goes to a of r of t equals L, provided the limit as t goes to a of the absolute value of r of t minus L equals 0. And notice these are all vectors, right? L is a vector, 0 a vector. Talking about vectors here. So let's break this down a little. So first of all, what is this definition saying? What does this mean? So basically, all we're saying is that if there exists a vector L such that the absolute value of r of t minus L can be made as small as we like by taking t close enough to a, then we can say that the limit as t goes to a of the vector value function r of t equals L. So this is really the same intuitive definition we used when we learned about taking limits of scalar functions. We're just using vectors here. So notice one important fact. So here L is a vector. So the limit of a vector valued function gives us a vector as the answer. So next, let's talk about how practically we take the limit of a vector valued function. So here I've written the following fact. The limit as t goes to a of the vector function r of t equals the vector limit as t goes to a of f of t, comma, limit as t goes to a of g of t, comma, limit as t goes to a of h of t. So basically what I'm saying here is that to take the limit of a vector valued function, then you're just taking the limit of each component. And that's going to give you a vector as an answer, and that's the limit of your vector valued function. And when you're doing this, the same limit laws you've learned in the past are going to apply when you take these individual limits of the components. And shortly, you'll have an opportunity to view a few examples of how this works. Let's also briefly touch on the idea of continuity for vector value function. Now, just like with limits, this is going to have pretty much the same meaning and the same properties as it did for scalar functions. So specifically, the vector function r of t is continuous at the point a if the limit as t goes to a of r of t equals r of a. Now, practically, what this means is that if all of the components are continuous at a, then the vector function is going to be continuous at a. Now, graphically, continuity for vector valued functions is going to have the same intuitive meaning that it did for scalar functions. So if a vector valued function is continuous on some interval, then when we sketch that vector valued function, we shouldn't see any breaks or jumps or gaps or anything like that on the interval where it's continuous.